pieces from this Pharaoh Mims book,
right.
And it's just poems from my first years of living in Austin, Texas. And they're easy to find online because the word doesn't exist.
Exactly.
So you will find
it now.
Pharaoh Meme.
Yeah.
Three very, very different themes. This first one's called Jumping from the Mausoleum. When I was young, I sang at our church.
Family, if you're operating in the Bay Area, Pastor Sam, your offer is ready.
I'll start. When I was young, I sang at our church, and as a female teen, I was a little peeved that I could never become a priest. But as a teenager, with nothing to do one night, me and a few friends went to the local cemetery. Once it got dark, brought along a couple of white sheets. Now, this was a small cemetery in a small town. It didn't have high fences or gates. So we just walked into the graveyard at night, and we waited by the mausoleum until we saw a car coming down the long road from the distance. That's when I'd get up onto the roof, throw a sheet over my body, and when the car would get close, just as I was about to make a turn near that cemetery, that's when I would jump to the ground in the darkness. My arms were out, I was covered with a white sheet, and we'd laugh, wondering if they thought they saw a ghost. I mean, this was what we did for fun, teenagers with nothing to do in the middle of nowhere. But my dad heard what happened, and he asked me in the next morning if I knew anything about what had happened at the cemetery the night before. I don't even remember what I answered, but as far as I know, we weren't doing anything illegal, no one was hurt. And it is kind of funny to imagine how those drivers reacted, wondering what they saw as they were driving down a lonely road by a cemetery.
Mm.
Did they think they saw a spirit? Ah, well, the church didn't want a female priest. I suppose it's for the best, because that church wouldn't be suited for me. I had more fun making people look toward the dead and question what they'd see.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's so funny because I was a bartender and we used to find people out in the graveyard on Saturday night because the town was so small.
Yeah.
And so who died that week, and other people get drunk down there, but that was the same thing. The graveyard is the wildest place in town.
The wildest place in town. This one is called Origin from the Macro to the Micro.
Oh.
Let's see how this one goes. The thought of it has always gone through our heads. Where did we come from? How did this all begin? When we think of our mom holding us when we were little, we wonder, there has to be something more. Something bigger, something more. This is what was ingrained into our American heads. We'd look up to the stars, and yes, some did that to understand the greatness of not only our world, but of the entire cosmos. Scientists figured out the laws of physics, and on the macro, this was their heaven, and this is where everything worked.
Mm.
I look at the gold wedding ring and engagement ring on my hand and think of the gold, the titanium, elements we value so much here on planet Earth because they're so rare. But thanks to astronomy, we know when the universe was formed, the only elements that were around were hydrogen, maybe helium. It was only when the energetic atoms gained mass and they clumped together and formed the first stars. Elements from carbon to iron were produced in the cores of stars in high-temp fusion reactions there. But what about those heavy rare elements we ascribe so much value to? Well, the scientists researched, that's what they do, until they discovered that the collision of neutron stars in our cosmos here have the energy to produce elements heavier than iron. An astronaut named Berger even said that, quote, they do it efficiently enough that they can account for all of the gold that's been produced in the universe. You might think that the death of stars is a nasty thing, and it is, but that science makes what we love. Wow. I love quoting astronomers when it works out so beautifully like that. But that is the micro. I'm only thinking about locally here, about the metal on my hands, the hematite that I wear, like what Mars rovers found. I look at the mountains and the canyons from the ice melts. I hear the babbling brook or see a flower in bloom. When I look around, I think that these things work too. But now pull it all off on a celestial scale to observe those close encounters between small galaxies and the outer edge of a larger galaxy, sending a spiraling to form an arm of a new spiral galaxy, not much unlike our own Milky Way. When elements in our bodies are formed by the stars, they make up the macro, and they make the macro micro, since we're made of stardust. Remember, the static on your televisions is not unlike the cosmic radiation scientists found when studying the universe, when they accidentally discovered the noise from the Big Bang. Wow, it almost makes me starry-eyed to think of what astronomical theoreticians might come up with for the next, because it's a scientist's job to postulate theories and work to prove or disprove. And really, how beautiful is that? Because once you get the right equations, macro or micro, that is when everything truly works. One last one for you. I kind of go for my different themes for each piece. This one's called Queen of Multimedia for a reason.
Yeah, imagine.
When people are offered a 10-minute time slot to perform poetry, yes. Some people call them poetry readings, but I call it a show.
Yeah.
Why? For instance, I incorporate music any way I can. Yep. When I can't do it live, I'll show for recordings from any musician friends. Mm-hmm. For years, I used PowerPoint to huge screens for my art to coincide with my poetry, mm-hmm. or else I display videos, either by making videos to display or by filming me while I read and showing my show live on a big screen. Mm-hmm. And no, I didn't play with props to distract people from the writing, but to incorporate different senses so the people who remember poetry with both sight and sound. And sure, they might have granted me the title Queen of Multimedia and Multimedia Diva back in Chicago, but it's more than that. It's more than throwing technology into poetry performance art shows. And I'm not trying to be the poetry shocky jock. I just look for different ways to get my message across and to hammer my poetic point home. And you know, sometimes it's fun to use more than just words. Once, I did a show of poems about other countries. I displayed on a screen a guitar, a giant drawing of a TV. And then I had my photo slideshow scrolled on this screen of my drawn TV. When I sat in a giant drawing of a giant chair, I clicked on a giant mock remote control button. Because if the world doesn't match what I want sometimes, maybe then I could just draw the world as I want to. And yeah, I can be all about the props by creating a Wink Martindale long, thin game show style microphone. But then it hold this mic that was perfect, and my Warhol wig and my 50s jacket, when I actually did a poetry feature that was called the Poetry Game Show. Other poets would read a poem of mine, and after I borrowed a sound pressure meter, I awarded the poet with the loudest applause with a paper Burger King crown adorned with Poetry Game Show winner flags. I did a show about conflicts with cops by wearing a prison orange outfit, removing my handcuffs from my feature, and then standing in front of a height ruler like I was getting my mugshot taken. I did a show where it was like I was on my cell phone after reading poems that were all in conversation. Because how many times have you just heard and been able to listen to someone else talking, loudly mouthing on their phone to the other world, where you're getting to hear everyone else's stories? I wrote a poem about being in an open book, and I read it in a show after using novel pages to make a paperback jacket. Because really,
well, we had operating in the bike center.
You,
right there,
you could guess a thing or two about me by listening to what I share. I still have that jacket in my library up on the poster, actually. Because, yeah, I've done a lot of shows, standing on a stage, just reading poems. But when it comes down to it, those aren't the shows that people remember. Mm-hmm. Because if you can incorporate people or props or music or video into a show, and it's something that people remember, well then, all that makes me think is that being a poet is one thing. But when it comes to poetry shows, maybe, maybe being the queen of multimedia isn't such a bad thing after all.
Yeah. That was that.